The JWST was designed to look as far back into the past as it could, but now it has set its sights on something less distant. The Space Observatory has taken several photographs of our neighboring red planet and made some atmospheric measurements. But before we can get to the images and the data, there is a serious question we need to address. What's the point of using the James Webb Telescope to look at Mars? Seems like a job that's kind of beneath what the JWST is meant to do, and that there are already satellites that monitor Mars that could likely get the same information that JWST could. The main reason is that some sort of calibration in preparation for analysis of exoplanets. Mars is a known variable, so it makes a good tool for comparison. That, or they wanted to see the station that Matt Damon left behind. Jokes aside, the JWST can image the full disk of Mars in one go, unlike the NASA spacecraft in orbit. This sort of observation can complement the more high-resolution measurements from the spacecraft. They do it because there's always a chance something new might come up. JWST is the world's most advanced telescope, and Mars is a possible place for a future human colony, so I guess why not? Here are some reasons why NASA could have undertaken the task. The first, calibrating to another rocky planet with an atmosphere in the search for habitable exoplanets. Second, searching for previously undiscovered patterns in infrared and near-infrared on and just below the surface of Mars that is impossible to see unless pictured on freezing cold sensors. And third, comparing actual results with theoretical models about Martian soil compositions, heating, and radioactive properties to better understand energy demands for potential near and far future terraforming projects. Mars is our only lifeboat at the moment, so it's pretty important to study. For every observation done on JWST, there are probably 50 other proposals that got rejected. So everything done on the telescope, you would assume would have a very concrete reason to be approved. It has a lower spatial resolution than spacecraft orbiting Mars, obviously, but it has different spectrometers. For example, Webb's unique observation post nearly a million miles away at the Sun-Earth Lagrange Point 2 provides a view of Mars' observable disk, the portion of the sunlit side that is facing the telescope. As a result, Webb can capture images and spectra with the spectral resolution needed to study short-term phenomena like dust storms, weather patterns, seasonal changes, and, in a single observation, processes that occur at different times of a Martian day. The top right, top left, and bottom left corners of the first image each have three lighter brown patches that break up the predominantly molted dark brown color. The color coding indicates that these lighter parts are brighter. Serritis Major, Hyugens Crater, and the Hellas Basin are all indicated by arrows. These images of Mars aren't all that impressive when compared to the super detailed imagery of nebula thousands of light years away, but then again, it really isn't meant to be used for such close proximity. Because it is so close, the red planet is one of the brightest objects in the night sky in terms of both visible light and the infrared light that Webb is designed to detect. This possesses special challenges to the observatory, which was built to detect the extremely faint light of the most distant galaxies in the universe. Webb's instruments are so sensitive that without special observing techniques, the bright infrared light from Mars is blinding, causing a phenomenon known as detector saturation. Astronomers adjusted to Mars' extreme brightness by using very short exposures, measuring only some of the light that hit the detectors and applying special data analysis techniques. Webb's first image of Mars, captured by the near-infrared camera or the NIR camera, show a region of the planet's eastern hemisphere at two different wavelengths of infrared light. This image shows a surface reference map from NASA and the Mars Orbiter Laser Altimeter, MOLA, on the left, with the two Webb NIR cam instrument field of views overlaid. The near-infrared images from Webb are shown on the right. After looking at these images, you might be thinking, the Hellas Basin is significantly lower than the surrounding terrain. Wouldn't it be expected to be warmer using a thicker layer of atmosphere? I think perhaps the higher atmospheric pressure in Hellas is acting as an insulator. Double the air mass means it takes longer to change temperature than the rest of the planet, so it still may be cool from the night before. The principal investor, Guillermo Villeneuve of NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center, who designed these Webb observation, pointed out that this is actually not a thermal effect at Hellas. It is a lower altitude, and thus experiences higher air pressure. That higher air pressure leads to a suppression of the thermal emission at this particular wavelength range due to an effect called pressure broadening. It will be very interesting to tease apart these competing effects in these data. They've recently developed the idea that under crater cliff edges or overhangs, there could be relief from the solar radiations that hit Mars. For ideas of where to set up camp, what you're looking at there is the atmospheric window. No, this isn't the emission spectra from the planet. You can see the x-axis is wavelength. Different materials absorb and release UV in specific ways. They look for specific patterns at different eve length to determine composition. The highlights just show each of the tessellae that correspond to a different component in the atmosphere. In basic terms, different elements and particles in the atmosphere will absorb certain wavelengths of light. If you know what those values are, you can analyze the wavelengths reflected off the planet and look at the full spectrum of light to figure out what parts got reflected and what parts got absorbed, refracted, or scattered by elements and particles in the atmosphere. If the wavelength profile for Mars is missing all parts on the spectrum that got blocked by atmospheric CO2, then that implies the pressure of CO2 in the atmosphere. Naturally, there's a lot more detail and nuance to it, but the principle is very simple. This lets us get to a pretty good idea of the composition of the atmosphere, and the tools that capture this information is one of the key improvements in JWST that earlier generations of space telescopes struggled with. Mars observation was made on September 5th and has released its observation in less than 2 weeks. We can now expect new observation to be released at a faster pace. The important thing to note here is that the JWST team is releasing preliminary findings before getting fully peer-reviewed, as they have been previously stating. My guess is that, because we do have an actual measurement of Mars' atmosphere from these ground probes, we can compare what their readings are with the atmospheric composition readings from the JWST. This will give us a good guideline for how accurate JWST is when it measures the atmospheric composition of distant exoplanets that we can't send probes to. So, there you are, guys. I hope this video offers some good insight. If you enjoyed it, be sure to hit that like button and subscribe for more content like this. As always, thanks for watching.